Hello everyone. Today I'm going to be talking a little bit about Margaret Mahler, and her separation individuation theory. Keep in mind as I go through and study each of these theorists, I'll be looking for behaviors of the personality disordered, and the subsequent failure in development of the self. I think you'll find this interesting, as you'll begin to see where key terms we use originate from, and their true meanings. In his book, Personality Disorders, Dr. James Masterson cites several early childhood developmental theorists, who remain influencers to this day, and help build the foundation of normal and abnormal psychological development. To talk about his work, one needs to talk about others in the field in an effort to understand the personality disordered individual. So, Margaret Mahler was a physician who later turned to studying psychiatry, namely the development of the self in early childhood. Some might already be familiar with her separation individuation stage theory, but first she describes the newborn infant going through the normal autistic and symbiotic stages. The autistic period from 0 to 2 months consists of a primitive hallucinatory disorientation in which the need for satisfaction seems to belong to his or her own unconditional omnipotent autistic orbit, Masterson, page 10. Basically, there is a barrier that protects the infant's psyche from being overwhelmed. From 2 to 4 months is the symbiotic stage. Here there begins a dim awareness of a satisfying object. As a side note, Mahler uses the term symbiosis as a metaphor, useful from biology. Here the infant is still in a delusional, hallucinatory state and behaves and functions with the mother as a dual unity. In this state there is still no differentiation from inner and outer, or of self and other. The organizing principles of psychological birth still lie with the mother's quote holding unquote behaviors. Next, is the separation individuation stage and its subphases. The first subphase, separation and individuation of body image, 3 to 8 months. Here the baby begins to be in a more awakened state with its perceptions focusing outward. It starts to compare the mother with others, and is apt to have stranger anxiety. However, it is noted that the baby's curiosity is just as strong. The second subphase, practicing, 10 to 15 months. This is broken down further into two more subphases, early and proper. Here the baby uses mother as a stable base, as uses mother as a sort of refueling station. Now, being able to walk and burgeoning cognitive abilities, the baby begins a love affair with the world. Emphasis is on practicing skills, and autonomy, seemingly oblivious to the mother. With the ability to move around freely, there is a giant step towards identity formation. The third subphase is rapprochement, 15 to 22 months. There is an increasing sense of separateness, and an increasing frustration. The child needs the mother to be emotionally available, as they have to give up their delusion of grandiosity. This often comes with dramatic fights with the mother. This is what is called the rapprochement crisis. Terrible twos or the rapprochement crisis, the child fights for their autonomy, yet needs the mother to fulfill all of their needs, without recognizing that mother is separate. The child sees the mother as an extension of itself, and is painfully becoming aware of this separation. Resolution of the crisis, object permanency. Here the child realizes that mother can be missing for a short period of time, and will come back to meet their needs, in other words regain omnipotent control. The fourth subphase is consolidation of individuation and the beginning of object constancy, 22 to 30 months. Here, object constancy becomes fluid and reversible. Because of increased cognitive functions, and verbal communication, the child is able to hold several mental representations of self and object. There is also the fantasy and reality testing. Also, there is increased body image, the differentiation of boy and girl as well as reliance on locomotion. As you can see there are several key points here when discussing narcissism or other personality disordered individuals. From my experience, one can theorize that the narcissist fails in several developmental tasks in what is probably very subtle ways. There is the grandiosity and omnipotence as well as the object constancy stages of development that become glaringly obvious in hindsight, having had to deal with such people. As it would seem, using Mahler's theory alone, the narcissist seems to be stuck, never having resolved the rapprochement crisis with the solution of object permanence, ever seeing others as an extension of their self. One thing's for sure, if you didn't know what you were looking for in a future NPD infant, you would likely miss the subtle failures in development and mark them off as odd, or off. In my next video I'll talk about Daniel Stern, according to Masterson, on normal child development. After that will be Dr. Squaer, who is inclined to look at child development through a neuroscience lens, and then on to Masterson. So, if anything here resonates with you, be sure to comment, and remember to subscribe and like. Follow me on Facebook at NarcissistFreeAlmost, and on Instagram at ClumberLover. I do hope everyone is doing well, and living peace of mind narc-free.